We have sworn in the testimony a couple times, but usually we don't. This is Wallingford, and we know everybody, well, I used to know everybody in town, I suppose, pastor, but in those days we did. I knew everybody in town. So we just assumed that everybody's honest with their testimony. But we have to record everything, because we're an adjunct to the Superior Court. We follow that is, we're part of the court system. The Superior Court had to use, had to settle all the land use problems that arise in the state. There's no way they could handle it. So they make it, they give a judicial power, sort of judicial power, to a local community of lay people like ourselves and myself. And I, my reputation is I like to tangle with attorneys anyway, so I have, you know, I just volunteer for it. So anyway, that's life, and that's how we do. But we're a volunteer group. So we're going to hear case number one. That would be the case that you were both notified, but you were not notified at specific times. The first case is a gentleman that we've had there for some time, for quite a while. It'll be case number 1701. And hearing the case tonight will be our recording secretary, Sarah. To my left is John Ensman. To my immediate right is Harold Sonny Cross. And next to him is Paul Kessalt. And to the right is my chaplain with the American Legion, my chaplain personally, Ron Shepard. And I'm Joe Cowett. I'm the volunteer of the CBA. Case 1701. The Rollinsford Board of Appeals will be in session on Tuesday, June 1st, 2017 at 7 p.m. at the Rollinsford Town Hall to continue the following appeal. Herbert LePan of 160 General Sullivan Way, Rollinsford, New Hampshire, seeking a lot line setback variance to install a prefabricated shed 3 feet from the existing lot line, whereas the zoning ordinance calls for 15 feet. And this notice was sent with the clerk telling me that it was notified.
Yes, Charles and Deborah Morgan, 172 General Sullivan Way, Bain Family Revocable Trust, 176 General Sullivan Way, Rita Conley Living Trust, P.O. Box 682, Ryan, New Hampshire, 03870, John and Marie, Maureen Schreiner, 164 General Sullivan Way, Edward Cloutier and Renee Boucher, 148 General Sullivan Way, Walter and Kathleen Hatchey, P.O. Box 725, Darren Anastasov, 100 Roberts Road, and the town of Rollinsford.
And notification was made in Foster's Daily Democrat on Monday, May the 29th. On page A3, and there was a news story written in that same date also. The public has been notified adequately. Now we'll go with the petitioner's presentation of the case. Mr. LePan, if you would. I'm not going to burden everybody with going through what we've gone through in the past. I think what we did, we gave you a second chance rather than just send you home with a denial.
Right.
Okay.
So I'm looking to get a 3 foot variance just because of the way my yard is set up, the way everything lies, that it's kind of like the only place I can put this particular shed. I've done a better drawing, and I think it illustrates the intentions that I have, or where I would like to place it, and makes it easier for you guys to see.
I think we were concerned that night about I can condense the remarks, but the possibility of your probably relocating that away so that the variance would not be required.
Right, and like I said, I did check it out, and like I said, there's really no other place I can put this shed without it being, you know, in the way of my actual living, my yard, you know what I mean?
Is there anyone else wants to speak in favor of the request?
I've got a letter, I don't know, I think I made copies, but I got a letter from the neighbor adjacent to me where the shed would be.
Can you read it?
Says, to whom it may concern, my next door neighbor, Herbert LePan, who lives at 160 General Sullivan Way, and I were talking several months ago. He asked if I would mind if I placed the shed to within 3 feet of my property line. I replied that it was fine. And then he signed his name, John M. Schreiner. He's the owner, 164 General John Sullivan Way.
Without any argument, I'll, if you present it to me, I'll use it as exhibit A. And this is clerk. I have received no communications, pro or con, on this particular case. Any other members of the board?
Yes. Yes, Mike.
Have you gotten any communication from anybody?
Oh, no.
No, okay.
Nobody.
Well, and nobody in the audience is ready to speak in support of the appeal, okay? Members of the board? Mr. Casal?
Yes, question I have, you know, I asked you the last time, what is your hardship, which is, what is different about your property so that you don't have to conform with the 15 feet setback? Because what I see is that you have two sheds already. They're both non-conforming structures.
They were there when I bought the house, so yeah, I don't know what to tell you there.
So they're covered.
Right.
Yep.
One shed is coming down. If you see the thing, the blue shed is,
yes,
to be taken down. And this, you know, some of the stuff I'm going to get rid of, some of the stuff I need to put in the new shed. So that would just clean up that area. And like I said, I got a leach field right in front, so I can't push it any closer. Down all in the back, which I've got pictures of, you go down through the pictures, there's probably the very last two pictures that are here and here. This shows the water that goes through my yard in the back, so I obviously can't put it there. Then I have, in the middle section, it's like, there used to be a pool there, so there's a bunch of sand and it was raised, so it's got, like wood or railroad ties around it. So I can't really, plus I have a flower bed and stuff like that. So if I moved it over, then I would have to dig into that area. And then it would take up the 15 feet. I would have no, I would lose 15 feet of my yard. So all that in the back would just be a useless part of my yard. You know, that I would not be able to, you know, see or whatever. This gives me more area where, you know, and like I said, it's you know, the neighbor directly next to me wrote me a letter, you know, saying he doesn't care, you know.
Yeah.
He showed him where it was and everything. He's like, yeah, whatever. He's like, you know.
I guess that the thing that concerns me is that the board sets a precedent, because I certainly would not want a neighbor to put a shed you know, 3 feet next to my property line. I just built a new house. I got land, you know, landscaping, which I did. So the next question I have is that you show a structure where that meets the requirements. So
right, I showed you that because there's a gate right in front of it. So if I put it there, it would be right in front of the gate, and that's really the only big enough access to get to the back of my yard where the septic guy comes in to clean the septic, and if I have to get in there to do my leaves, stuff like that, so that would obstruct that gate. So that's why this, where the yellow one is, where I want it, is right at the edge of the gate. So that way I could still get in through and have the room.
Any other members got any questions, concerns, or positive remarks?
If I could ask a question, Mr. LePan, you're going to be taking down the shed marked in blue.
Yes.
Why couldn't you put the shed over there and you'd have room to, it looks like you've got 11 feet with the shed you're not going to knock down, four more feet over and put it where that loop shed would be, and then you'd be conforming.
Because when they deliver it, they have to, they have a big flatbed that they have, and I've got no access to get over there. You know what I mean? There's a fence on both sides of the thing. My neighbor's yard, I'm sure my neighbor doesn't want a flatbed coming in, and I'll have to take down part of the fence, and it's a metal chain fence on that side, so that means, you know, they're probably cemented in, stuff like that, you know? I was just, you know, going for the easiest possible solution for that. And plus, like I said, the leach field, it's starting to encroach on the leach field going that way.
All right, thank you.
What piqued my interest is that this is not really in the outskirts, but nobody's been complaining about it.
About the what?
About your project.
No, not at all. I've talked to all my neighbors, you know, and like I said, they're actually wondering why it's taking so long. But I just, you know, I said, oh, you know what? I had bad drawing, you know, stuff like that, you know.
Well, like I told you last time, we're trying to protect you probably more than anybody else, because of the variances that we grant, you know, that stays with the records, with the Register of Deeds. So if that property came up for sale, we might have a problem with the financing and so on and so forth. In fact, most of that land around there used to be farmland.
Mm-hmm.
It used to be cows.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I almost developed a baseball field in there. But Mrs. Stockdale passed away a little bit earlier than I anticipated. So we now we got about 50, 60 homes in there. I still would like to see the cows back there myself. Not that I anything against the neighbors, they're all good people. But it's the community, I've lived here all my life, so the community was always a farm property. But, you know, we've had cases there, like Kelvin Park, that we had the whole neighborhood was here, so opposed to it. And we had to grant it, because the lady had done her work. And it was very technical, we could not go any. You know, we don't really have to follow every measure of the ordinance. They make that very clear. And your state and your state statutes and your federal statutes, especially the state. So no two cases are the same. But I think here, if we're talking about giving you, we gave you a second chance, because it would have been denied, I'm quite sure, the first time, because we got boundaries. We used to get boundaries here. So I don't know, the only comments I had was that if somebody was opposed to it, I think I would have heard about it.
I just want to make a comment.
Something.
Compared from the first to this, well done.
Thank you.
However it turns out for you, just an opinion, well done.
Thank you.
Excellent job.
Thank you. Well, you know, like I said, I mean, it was a learning process for myself. I mean, I didn't know, you know, I was putting in a shed. I didn't think that, you know, I was going to need so,
quite
to be, so,
call,
to be
huh?
so much, you know, in involved, you know. But now I know, and, you know, I learned something.
Any further comments? Any comments from the public? Hearing none, we're probably ready for a vote.
Great.
And the vote will be a yes vote, will be granting the request, the requested variance. A no vote will be denying it. And when we make a decision, we must have to have some sort of a basis to state why we are making that decision. That's something that's required of the jury, so it's a little bit different than the normal jury, I guess. Yeah, that's what land use advocates do. So I will start with, I guess I'll go to my left, Mr. Hensley.
Mr. LePan, I think you've done a nice job with the presentation, and I have sympathy for you. I do. I'm concerned that I've taken several drives past your property, and I've seen other people in your neighborhood with lots with sheds in the back area, three or four. I'm concerned about whether or not there's a true hardship here and diminution of property values and it being a bit too extreme, being too close to the line. So, unfortunately, I have to vote no against the variance.
Okay. Sonny.
All right.
Mr. Forbes.
I support this. One reason, you got that letter that I'd asked for, because Schreiner wasn't here. And hearsay wouldn't do any good. If Schreiner doesn't have a problem, why should I? It's going to affect his property, not mine. That's my viewpoint on it, and it's your property and his, it's not ours. So therefore, my vote is yes.
Mr. Gasol?
I vote no, because I don't see a hardship which is inherent to the land, and second of all, it's against the spirit and the intent of the ordinance, and that is to preserve space between houses.
Mr. Shabbat?
I will also vote no, because it's against the spirit of the ordinance.
Mr. Cowett would vote yes, because I think you've done what we asked you to do. And I can't dispute the majority vote, because you are not meeting the ordinance requirements. But I think you've made a pretty good presentation, and I think we have the authority to weigh it one way or the other. So the...
So if I want to appeal this? Oh, can I?
You could appeal it, but it's going to be completely different from what you're giving us now. You have you have 30 days to be able to appeal it. Come in with a new plan, find out where you think you deviated. I really come with a different plan altogether. In other words, if you're going to move it somewhere where the variance is not required, you don't even have to come to us. Go to the selectmen. They'll send you to the planning board. I don't think you go to the planning board with that. You go to the board selectmen and wait for the occupancy here. It can be appealed. Oh yes, and then we review the appeal. And then if we turn it down again, then it goes to the superior court.
Right.
Then I would not do that on my own. I'd get some legal counsel though.
Right. So Paul, obviously it's basically you two. So you know.
Three.
He's not my concern. It's you two. Because you guys seem to be the ones that are so intent on this, on saying no. I think he is on, but you two, what can I do to make you happy? I can't do the 15. I just can't do it. You know? What would make you happy? Looking at this, and what I told you, like I said, there's the gate, there's the 15, there's the water issue. There's the issues that are there that I've explained to you. So I'm just wondering what you think should happen.
Well, I see too that, that you already use your land with this permanent landscape. So you enjoyed the full use of your property.
So you want me to stick a shed in the middle over here? So 15 feet of my land. So I'm going to have 15 feet in the back of my shed. That's just going to be, I'm going to be looking at my shed and then nothing behind it.
If this was my property, and if I did this, I would say, hey, I decided to put the waterfall with the permanent landscape, and I can't put another structure where I want it. I can't put the shed.
Okay. So this goes, this case 7001 is adjourned. Case 1702. The Rollinsville Zoning Board of Appeals will be in session on Thursday, June 1st, 2017, at 7 p.m. at the Rollinsville Town Hall to hear the following appeal. Oak Street Storage LLC of 163 Cranberry Meadow Road, Berwick, Maine, to seek a variance from Article 542A and Table 69, permitted uses to allow for the construction of a self-storage facility without sewer or water utilities in the Country Residential District, Tax Map 3, Lots 37 and 38. Signed by myself, as the Chairman of the Board of Appeals, with the Secretary, read us the list of the abutters notified.
KL Corporation, P.O. Box 293, York Harbor, Maine, 03911. Michael Poplowski, 126 Oak Street, Rollinsford. Anthony Clendon, 180 Oak Street. Peggy Clendon, 160 Oak Street. Douglas and Denise Needhoff, 136 Oak Street. Michael Noonan, P.O. Box 977, Early New Hampshire, Oak Street. Stephanie Simpson, 116 Oak Street. Mary and Patricia Weeks, 23 Rollins Road. Boston Main Railroad. Iron Horse Park, High Street, North Billerica, Massachusetts, 01862. Richard A. Cochran, P.O. Box 452, Dover, New Hampshire.
Present.
121 Broadway, LLC, 340. Central Ave, CQ2, Dover, New Hampshire, 0320, Civil Works, New England, PO Box 1166, Dover, New Hampshire, 0321.
Okay, in this case, it's also posted in Foster's Daily Democrat on Monday, May the 29th, with an article, a news article on that same date, same newspaper. And if you would state your name, because for the help of the secretary when she, you've been through cases before, right? Civil consultant, is that right? State your name and make your appeal.
My name is Dana Lynch. I'm a professional engineer and I'm with Civil Works, New England. We're in Dover, New Hampshire. And I'm here this evening on behalf of the applicant, Oak Street Storage, LLC. I'm not an attorney, I'm a civil engineer. And usually I don't represent zoning cases we used to a lot years ago, but as time has gone on, they become more complex and a little more contentious. But this one seemed fairly straightforward, what the applicant was asking for. I figured I could explain the case and hopefully answer your questions and allow you to render your opinion. If it pleases the board, I have a handout of photos, and I will give them to anyone here that would like them as well. These are cleaner versions of the aerial photos that I included in the package. They did not print well. There's a lot of blue in that. So there's three in each package, okay? So there's 2005, 2010, and 2015 aerial photographs.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Anybody?
I have extra copies here. I have
two. Four? Yes.
Oh, no, no.
Thanks.
Thank you. I just provided these. I'll get to it in a moment as to what.
Oh, sure.
Currently, this is a vacant piece of property located immediately adjacent to the B&M Railroad property on Oak Street. And the applicant wishes, it's currently used, as you can see in those photographs, for storage of materials or vehicles. And the applicant wishes to construct a self-storage facility. This is an unmanned self-storage facility, so it would be secured by a fence. We have a pass key. There would be 10 by 10 storage units in there. Provided you with a concept plan of how those units might lay in there. This is not a completed site plan. We are, again, looking for use variance. So we wanted to show generally the scope and magnitude of what that use might be. we still would need to go through the survey and site design process and get a site plan approval from the planning board should we get a favorable response from you folks. So this is the first step in a multiple step process. We are asking again for a use variance, as Country Residential does not allow for a self-storage facility. And we're also asking for a variance from a specific segment of your articles or your ordinances with regard to water and sewer utilities being provided to us to a site, which I'll touch upon in a moment. I'm sure you're all familiar with the location, but it is, as I said before, directly adjacent to the B&M Railroad lines. In fact, I understand that the most immediately adjacent track is a staging track. Across the street is Salmon Falls Stoneware. Along one edge of this property, there is a 16.5-foot wide easement that was granted to AT&T in a court case back in 2008. What you will see on the concept plan that I provided for you, we are still holding to the residential, country residential setback lines. So in other words, we're not asking for a variance from the setbacks. We're only asking for a variance to allow the use. So in other words, we're keeping these buildings set back 25 feet from the property lines. That does two things for us. One is we don't have to ask for that variance. We're trying to keep this as low key as possible. The other thing is because of that 16.5-foot wide easement along the northerly edge of the property adjacent to the railroad, the AT&T easement, we didn't want to create any conflict with that and have the buildings too close to that easement. It doesn't show on the plan that I provided for you. It wasn't part of the survey work that was done in 1984. This plan was surveyed in 1984, which has an interesting component to it, which I'll get to in a moment as well. Back right now, if you'll notice on the concept plan, this survey conducted in 1984 shows a retaining wall, a couple of tanks, a 30,000-gallon tank, a 20,000-gallon overhead tank, a couple of 12,000-gallon tanks, and a loading rack. Probably most of you here are far more familiar with what that was exactly and who it was used by. My point in mentioning that to you is this parcel has a history of being used for commercial purposes, probably due to its adjacency to the B&M Railroad line. As I said before, and as you probably can see from the aerial photographs that date back about 10 years, in 2005, we can see that there are some disturbed areas. It appears what was a small building on the lot, and some other uses of the lot. 2010, fairly vacant parcel of land, not very well treed. And then in 2015, along one edge of the property, and again, this is not a boundary survey, this is just an outline of the parcel as it relates to the surrounding uses. It appears that it's just used as a storage yard for some boats and cars and things like that. As I said before, we are proposing to construct two 20-foot wide buildings of a length to be determined by the site grading, but they will house 10 by 10 storage units. We feel that this is a reasonable, passive, low-impact use between what is in a residential use to our, generally to our south, and the railroad to our north. So this use will actually act as somewhat of a buffer, not a noise buffer per se, but a visual buffer between the residential use and the railroad line. The facility will be unmanned, and therefore we only will require electrical and security services. There'll be no sewer or water on this property for a couple of different reasons. If in fact this property could be served by sewer and water, first of all, water might be an issue because it doesn't have a direct access, but it would require a well perhaps, and the well radius would not fit entirely within the parcel. Furthermore, if we need a septic system on the property, we're not so sure that we can get the necessary setback to the property line, given the soil conditions out there. So needless to say, it may be not impossible, but it would be a challenging prospect to get sewer and water on this property. So therefore, it's even more appropriate to ask for a facility or use of a use which would not require either sewer or water. We don't believe there'll be any diminution of the value of the adjacent properties. We think that literal enforcement of the zoning use restriction would not provide any reasonable use of the land, given the proximity to the active railroad use, approximately 40 feet away, and the fact that we have some well and septic limitations. We do not feel that it would be contrary to the public interest to grant this variance. In fact, it may be able to be utilized by some residents of Rollinsford, if they so choose. And we do not think that it will be contrary to the intent of the zoning ordinance. And then lastly, in accordance with your criteria, we do not feel the variance will result in any granting of the variance will not result in a substantial injustice. So essentially, what we're proposing here is the construction and use, construction on and use of a parcel that has been vacant for some time now, as evidenced by the photographs, and was formerly used for commercial purposes, and we would like to continue to use it as a commercial purpose. Therefore, we ask for the variances requested. Happy to answer any questions you might have.
Yeah, I took some time to review it, to post it, because I couldn't find it in Section 6 in the land use. But you're quoting 542A, which 542B, 2A, sanitary water supply and sewage disposal provided the proposed structure meets all setback requirements. But, you know, to me, I thought that this should have been put through as a special exception. But the history of that piece of property, I remember it more when there was two storage tanks for gas. In the last 10 to 15 or 20 years, it's gone through all kinds of usage. But for a long time, way back to the forest fires in 1947, you always had two storage tanks up there. Right. I don't know what gas company it was, but anybody else recall those? Anybody can go back that far? We don't know that far.
Montgomery Ward used to be located right down in here.
Montgomery Ward had a facility down here too. That's true.
Go ahead, Bob. Yeah, I know we're showing our age.
But,
can I ask a question? Hi, I'm Andy Cochran from Salmon Falls Stoneware. Who owns this? Is this the Montgomery Ward's part here?
I think it was back there.
Who owns that property?
That's listed on here as behind this as a
the same owner as
Robert and L. Patricia Demers.
Rob Demers.
Oh, that's on the old plan from 1984.
Right. That's the old.
This is all I got to go by. I mean, without the map.
That's a switchboard for B&M. They used to switch the trains.
I think it's
public. No, that's in front of us.
Further up. Okay.
That's down here.
Okay.
That's gone.
Bill Ramos.
I want to mention something else. Yeah. Do you realize your company represented another individual for the same piece of property about 5 years ago?
Yes.
I'm going to guess.
Mr. Connolly.
And it was denied because, okay, then you're well aware.
Well, I'm not well aware. He looked at it. I don't know if he, are you sure it's Civil Works, not Civil Consultants?
It was Paul Connolly.
Oh, it was Paul,
right,
okay.
You are.
Okay. I haven't spoken to Paul about this at all.
Okay.
It was a tough one for us to deny because the gentleman is a volunteer in this town. He still is, matter of fact. And I knew his parents from Milford, New Hampshire, as a matter of fact. And he was going to be involved with heavy equipment.
He wanted a contractor's building, but the
residents... It was going to be heavy equipment over the Oak Street Bridge, you know. And
the residents really raised a lot of noise about the added traffic on the street.
I felt bad enough as it is. The traffic is terrible on that street.
Yes, yeah.
And if I remember correctly, the time when that was happening is when the bridge was apart. Yeah. So, I mean, it was, you know, you go into the bridge and you ain't going no further. Unfortunately, I have to agree with him, you know. take the bridge out on the main border, we'd be better off.
Really, it would. I wish they would work on it again so that the road would close.
But to go back to where I was getting at, you put in as a variance, and I guess we've been treating this as a variance because it's really, if you look further down in section 6, non-conforming use, and there's no use over there, but someone that needs a special exception, the bank on Oak Street is a good example of that. They didn't have the space requirement to put a bank there, but they came in before us for a special exception to their property. They had the land use, but there wasn't a good land. You get nothing but a cliff and back. So they didn't have it, so we gave it to them. And the planning board agreed to it and everything else. And we have the ability here to, under special exceptions, to grant cases like this. In other words, you know, I always assumed that we can't grant anything that's not a land use. Well, it's under the land use table.
Chairman?
Can I ask a question, please? How are you going to get into the property?
The proposal would be to utilize the 30-foot right-of-way that services both those pieces, those lots.
Who owns the right-of-way, sir?
I've not done deed research to that, but I know that I have been informed that the right-of-way is available for use by these properties. I'd have to do the research. I heard that.
So you don't really know if authorization's been given to use that right-of-way for a commercial use?
If we can't use the right-of-way, then we won't use the right-of-way.
How will the customers access the property?
Via the frontage that they have.
Sixty-nine feet across the front?
Yes.
You don't even meet the minimum frontage.
No, but it's a lot of record.
Well, it's a change of use, too.
That's what I'm asking for, is a change of use.
Yeah. I'm almost starting to think we're getting the cart before the horse here.
In what way, sir?
Well, you want to change the use of it. You don't have, you're trying to rely on the old usage of the 69 feet. In reality, you should have to bounce back to the new requirements as soon as you want to make change of use.
Well, the intent is to use the 30-foot right-of-way if it's available.
Well, I understand that. That makes sense. But I couldn't want to consciously even think to give you authorization if you don't know for sure you're going to be able to use somebody else's property. I mean, you saw what that gentleman went through, and he wasn't using anybody's property.
Yeah, no. And I understand where you're coming from. Again, I would kind of like to direct the discussion a little bit. These issues that you're bringing up are good issues, but they're issues that typically get addressed at the planning board level under the site review process. So when you raise a question about the adequacy of the width or your adequate traffic or any of those issues, those are not, I don't mean to tell you what you should or shouldn't do, but those are typically not zoning board issues. Those are planning board issues during the site review. So I could run through this scenario right now. If you were to grant the use and say, yes, you can build storage units there, but the next step in order to get a building permit is to go to the planning board. The planning board could say, you know what, we don't like this plan at all and kick it out, and that's the end of it. But we can't go to the planning board unless we know that there's an opportunity to use it for storage. So that's, and again, I'm saying that respectfully just so that.
At one time we used to handle site reviews. Then we just
had them back.
No, I don't want to get it back.
Lots of
planning board.
So if that's what you mean, cart before the horse, that's why we're...
Well, I understand where I'm coming from, and you know...
So if there are issues you have with the site itself, those are definitely worthy issues for site review. Yeah. The question is this a reasonable use of the property?
Chairman, can we hear from the public? Because Public is done.
Yeah, we have.
Oh, they are, okay.
You got another gentleman back there.
Yes, sir.
So if you look at the.
Give me a hand in there.
My name is Doug Neehock, I'm 136 Oak Street.
I'm sorry, say it.
Doug or Douglas Neehock, 136 Oak. If you look at the picture, my property is in the bottom right hand.
Which picture is that, sir?
All three of them, it's actually in the bottom right hand corner, it chops off my house right here, yep. So I was here 5 years ago and the other gentleman was asking to be able to use that property for the heavy equipment business. And at that time, I had shared with you guys that on occasion when me and my family pull out of our driveway on Oak Street, we will get passed because we do not pull out of the driveway quick enough. So I know that he's saying that, you know, to talk about traffic in this setting is inappropriate, but I think it's highly appropriate to talk about whether or not we should use this property to, for people to be pulling in and out of in that capacity. I don't know how frequent it would happen, but I can tell you from my standpoint, I've lived there 11 years and it is not an incident that happened once. It's rather frequent that we have issues pulling in and out of our driveway because of traffic.
Yes, I agree, same with me. Almost killed every time you go out.
You need to give me your name.
Sorry, Peggy McClendon, 160 Oak Street.
The only other couple of things I had to say was, my concern is somebody brought up precedent earlier, so if we allow this use, there are other properties back there. What precedent does that set for the other properties to be used or other properties around me? I bought my property to, as a resident.
It's a word we don't even think of.
Excuse me?
Land use boards don't even think of a precedence. No such thing as a precedent. Every case rests upon itself.
I know when we talked about the shed earlier, we said it.
That's right, we were giving some leeway for that.
Okay.
We have the authority to do that. We have the authority to be very firm.
The last thing I want to bring up is the use of it. So if it's going to be unmanned, who's to say that people will not be living in these in this day and age?
Really?
I don't, if nobody's going to be on site, it'll be secured with only electricity. I walk in the morning, sometimes I'll go up by Dover Ice Arena and there are people sleeping in their cars up in the ice arena.
Yeah.
I cannot be sure that people won't be sleeping in the storage shed. And those are my concerns.
As well as mine.
From another guy?
Excuse me?
I'm sorry.
Oh.
Board?
Do you want to know my opinion?
Yes.
My opinion is that the right of way must, I don't know for sure, but I would think the people that have this building back here probably would own the right of way. And that's why I said, who owns that? And then Acme Sheet Metal works next door to them. Mike's not here tonight, right? And then the buses, all the school buses turn around in our parking lot now. But the problem is the
which parking lot?
The Pottery's parking lot, Sam and Paul's Pottery, we let all the school buses turn around. But the problem with the bridge is they changed the weight limit for the big trucks. So big trucks are getting stuck and they have to turn around or go over the bridge. So if you put this thing here, more and more trucks are going to, if they want to build something and it's within the law, that's their, it's their land, they pay for it. But somehow, I don't know how you're going to get people in here when the traffic is bad, but that's for them to figure out, right? If they have a right of way. It's a commercial area.
Yeah.
And the people are living in the woods all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just that it's the neighborhood. Oh, yeah. All the time.
Also, my Garrison Hill.
down.
See, this is what we've got to consider.
What is eight?
Let's give this some thought over. Granting the variance must not be contrary to the public interest, right? The proposed use is not contrary to the spirit of the ordinance. Granting the variance would do substantial justice. The proposed use would not diminish surrounding property values. Denial of the variance would result in unnecessary hardship to the owner. If you're applying for variance, you must first have some form of determination that your proposed use is not permitted without a variance. The only question I seem to hear now, I mean, the prevailing problem seems to be one of traffic, safety, and so forth. There's no doubt that that piece of property has been an eyesore for a long time. Across the street, no. I mean, what you people did with the stoneware was a piece of art, really. Of course, the people that live the further up, the Catalpo friends and all that, their property is beautiful property. But when you approach the B&M Railways, it's always been an eyesore. Even when we had to take a bus to Dover High, we hated to go through that section of town. So it was kind of appealing to me in some ways that maybe they're going to have a storage facility there. Where that diminishes all that, but then the neighbors tonight come up with something that I really wasn't considering too much. It is an eyesore of traffic. The only good thing about that light on Oak and Broadway, it changes. That's one of the great things that they've done. You don't have to sit there all day. And I go through that property sometimes 2 or 3 times a day. That's certain sections of law. I'm not going back to the old Kidder Press days. I mean, what the Ducker songs had now, but even in those days, we didn't have the traffic you have today. Now you got all the main traffic taking a shortcut into Dover, downtown Dover, towards the Miracle Mile. You still follow the Miracle Mile? I don't know.
We do.
But the appellant is right in this instance, though, but he can't go to the planning board for site review unless he gets through the Board of Appeals on those variances. In my mind, right now, the only impediment I seem to have is the one of safety with traffic. But here again, he could probably contest that. Sir?
And my desire is not to contest that with you, but I would offer up the fact that the planning board will be asking for a number of different pieces of information, one of which will be our impact on traffic. They'll be looking for us to provide them with background information on site distance. They'll be looking at issues such as trip generation, how many vehicles will be entering and exiting this facility during peak hours of traffic, you know, in the morning and the evening, or whatever times of day there are high volume traffic on Oak Street. So we'll be looking at all those different items, and the planning board will probably send it out for an independent review, I'm guessing. So I'm not the planning board, I don't want to speak for them, obviously, but having appeared before the planning board in Oliver a few times, I know that they leave no stone unturned. Let's put it that way.
Can I ask some questions, Mr. Chairman?
Sure.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Good evening, Mr. Lynch. I have a couple questions for you. How did you determine that there would be no diminution of surrounding property values if the variance is granted? Do you have any studies or reports?
No, I don't, but it was fairly obvious to me that in looking at the aerial photographs and looking at the way the site appears right now, it is pretty much used as a storage yard for either I don't know if the vehicles function or not. There's trailers there, there's boats there. There's a lot of debris around the site. And it seemed that if you could clean up the site, you could enclose the whole site with a fence, a security fence, and construct structures within that security fence that were storage facilities, but nonetheless more attractive than just random vehicles laying around the yard, that would not in any way diminish the value of the adjacent properties. And in fact, I'm going to guess that the planning board will also want us to address landscaping. And if we address landscaping and we provide some type of buffer between this facility and the adjacent residential uses, we could actually be improving the situation, because then they're not only are they not looking at vacant vehicles, but they're also going to be intercepting a little bit of the sound from the railroad tracks. That immediately adjacent, that railroad track right there, I understand is a staging area for the trains that are either queuing up to go into Dover or back up towards Portland. And they sit and they idle at night. So I would think that having another set of buildings there, perhaps with some landscaping or other treatments around the site, that it would help to buffer that impact for the adjacent properties. And that's how I came up with the logic that it did not diminish the value of the adjacent residential use.
I'm not sure, but I think the vehicles parked there are Mike Pawlowski's. In the picture I noticed, I think it was his boat. I think he had sold it. So I think it might use that. He might use that as overflow parking. I don't recognize all the vehicles, and I can't speak to all of them. But I can say that the train is my wind chimes. It's part of the reason why I like living there. I like listening to it, so those don't bother me.
Yeah, they wake me up in the morning to check them out. I'd go to bed more peacefully tonight knowing that maybe we didn't, that you advanced this to the planning board. But I would sleep better if I did not put a caveat to our acceptance. That would be my, I'm just speaking for myself, I'm not speaking for the other four members, that the planning board looked very seriously upon the traffic situation. I know they're going to have you do a traffic study. We used to have to do it when we had the, when we used to do the site reviews. And quite a few other things. You're going to have the wires across the road for a couple of weeks. But that's why they get paid to do that. And definitely, and then they'll have the questions when it comes to the site reviews, when it comes to the, but you can't proceed anyways if we turn it down here tonight.
And I'm content to have the record show that that is a concern of the board. That's fine.
Well, I would make it, I would even accept a motion to that effect. I would make that a condition, but before the vote. That we make a condition to the planning board, if we accept it tonight, that they study very seriously the safety issue because of the concerns of the neighbors. They expressed it tonight. And these are responsible neighbors. We have some that are very successful.
We didn't even consider that in the last one. They convinced us and we said no.
No. At that time, that was heavy. There was heavy equipment.
But there was less per day. He said it would be three trips a day. These people, it's an unknown amount.
Yeah.
I mean, how many times you can tell someone they can or can't go to their storage unit? And what would you figure? 50 storage units?
Probably in that vicinity, okay, 50 to
75.
Yeah, there's trip generation data available from the Institute of Transportation Engineers. They study a multitude of sites across the country, and they count the cars going in and out of these types of facilities. And that's what we base our estimate on, if that's the best available data.
Can I ask a couple other questions, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Mr. Lynch, this property could be used for a one or two or a multiple family residence, a bed and breakfast, a hotel, a motel, or inn, right?
Mm-hmm.
So why can't the property be used in conformance with the statute?
As I mentioned before, the issue is well radius to put a well on the site and to get a septic system on the site. It's a very small site. It's less than an acre.
So
it's very narrow for, given the setbacks and for, they're required by the state of New Hampshire for those uses, the septic system and the well.
So you have reports that back up that you can't put a septic or well on there?
We have done no studies out there to that effect. I just know from my 35 years of working with those regulations that those are the general requirements, what the general requirements are.
Just to add to that. So, can you tell me how granting the variance would result in substantial justice?
Well, I think it would allow the owner to utilize the property for the intended use or his desired use, first of all. And I think, secondly, it does nothing to harm any of the, to be contrary to the public, to the town's ordinances in any way, shape, or form. I mean, I guess the way I would put it back to the board is, if a house was built there, would you want to live next to the railroad tracks? Maybe somebody would, but generally speaking, that's not going to be what I would call a desirable location. It would be very difficult to construct a home there and have it sell at any kind of market value on such a narrow lot directly adjacent to the railroad. That railroad.
You know, by the way, to just across the railway, I recall this house, which is very close to the mm-hmm. railway also, mm-hmm. either being demolished and a new one built or...
did it catch on fire?
Or catch on fire. Right. And I remember it selling it very quickly. So I respectfully, I think I have some questions about your assertion that someone wouldn't want to live there. In fact, someone could live well back from Oak Street.
My house is in that picture. I do live there. I don't believe it's somebody walked it. I do and have for 11 years.
I believe it's going to be an eyesore, too. I don't really want to go on my backyard and see all these storage units. I'd rather see a bed and breakfast.
Mr. Lynch, you don't think that you could tap water and sewer from the city of Dover?
I don't. It doesn't matter. I don't even know.
Do you folks have water and sewer from Dover?
I have Dover water and septic.
Dover water.
Yeah. Dover water.
Septic.
Septic.
Yes, septic.
Again, we just don't. We don't have. We have no intention of using either one of them because there would be no reason to have them on site. We don't want to encourage that kind of use on the site. As far as people sleeping in these units, in order to get into this place, you've got to have a key pass to get into the place. You've got to have a lock to get into the unit, and there's going to be security cameras on this place, too.
But even if they have a key, it doesn't mean that they're not going to live there.
They will be observed living there, I would think, if that event eventuality ever occurred.
Well, I think this board here, we're at the gate, you know, we're at the gateway. We could kill this whole process by just voting it down tonight. But we can allow him to proceed to the planning board where he goes through a site review process. It's too bad that the site review doesn't precede the appeals section. But I know we were on that a long time ago. I don't want to take it back. But we used to have a lot of fun with it. Because really, site review is a very extensive issue. And then you really act as a board of appeals. But I think if we want to allow this to proceed, I think he meets with the planning board in a couple of weeks, I told him we could do whatever.
We have not even begun the site design process yet because the applicant doesn't want to spend, that process is of thousands and thousands of dollars. Yes. And what he wants to find out, first of all, is if this is even allowable by getting the variance.
Coming through the judicial body first.
Right.
Which is fine.
Right. Then he ventures into the land of big bucks.
So that's why, you know, anybody wants to volunteer for the position of the town, don't volunteer for the Board of Appeals. Volunteer for the Planning Board, Selectmen, something like that. But not the Board of Appeals. I've been in it since its beginnings.
I guess, Mr. Casalt, Chairman, my comment is that this is the first request is a variance for a non-conforming use in a urban residential zone.
Right.
That's
what it is.
Country. Yeah. So they're going to erect a commercial buildings, basically, and that's against the spirit and and the intent, you know, but now the hardship is that they can't put a, you know, a septic tank because of the requirements of the state. You need like 100-foot setback, I think. Well, no, I forgot, I'm thinking about the well. But you need certain setbacks. But I'm just, I can't say that because it seems like the hardship is not clearly defined to me. So I don't, and so the applicant, to me, has not proven a hardship. You know, it's a non-conforming lot. We all know that. And if he had a use which was conforming, then we could grant him a special exception if we decided that he didn't need a sewage system, a septic tank.
Yeah, I guess everything would be right with the world if you were coming in for establishing a new outdoor garden function, I guess, you know.
That's a good idea.
That would take care of everybody's concerns.
Yeah.
Wouldn't add much to the tax base, but.
Well, yeah, that might be a valuable piece of property.
Yeah.
Really, it would be. But with the history of the town, I don't know, the history of that section of the town. I mean, it's a long ways from the old Kidder Press. Cars were parked on that road all the time in those days, because Kidder Press was one of the biggest press companies in the country. They bought the presses of the greatest newspapers in the country, really. Okay, anything else? Are we ready for a vote? And
no, I got one question.
On
this map that you provided?
Yes, sir.
It shows, looks like four different lots.
Is that map free? Yes. Yeah.
Let me get the glasses on.
Yes, it is. I can find it.
It said, yeah, it says revised April 1st of 2016.
Are you looking at my concept plan? I'm sorry, I don't know which map you're looking at.
Terra map?
Thank you, Chris. Do you see it?
Counter Rawlinson?
Yes, oh. Yes, the tax map 3 in the lower right hand corner.
11.
11, okay. Yes, sir.
Well, I got to assume this little building way out here must be that house that's way in back.
Out beyond lot,
the power lines,
lot 36-1, that's the cemetery. If you go back to tax map 3, that map actually shows the location of our site. It's very small, very small. But if you can find a railroad line in the middle there, our lots, starting at the line at the bottom where Oak Street is located, are 38 and 39, okay? Mm-hmm. And then behind that is 36, which is the so-called Demers lot, and it's now Poplowski. And then if you look further back, you see where it says cemetery?
I do.
I believe that's what that square is on tax map 11.
Okay.
Because our lots are way up front, and they're nowhere near that.
Are you looking at lots 38, 37, and 36?
May I approach the bench?
Yes, sir.
Just want to make sure we're looking at the same thing. It's like communicating here an idea by email. So our lots are 38 and 37.
No 36.
No 36. So those three lots enjoy this right away. But I haven't done the research for that. They're part of, this is 36-1. This lot enjoys the ability to trans.
Is this where the house is, or whatever building this is out back there?
That's 36-1. Okay, it was a house. It's torn down now. It's kind of a storage site. Okay.
All right.
So this lot right
here. I have to go check on my dogs. I'll be right back.
And this way back here, off this plane, is the cemetery.
see where you look at that.
Maybe we all want to go to the beach this month, see it.
May I write anywhere, just to help?
Yeah, he's saying it's these two, here's the tracks. And this is.
No. We're being recorded, you have to be careful what you say.
Okay, these are the two lots in question.
Go ahead and take a look.
Notice that right away is the service lot.
You have.
Now, the only deed I have, I don't have any of this, but I happen to learn most deeds for this, says specifically that they enjoy the ability to access
through the right of way.
Through the right of way. So it is highly likely, although I have no evidence.
This one would do the same thing.
Correct.
Think.
That's okay.
But I, you know, because.
They don't know who you are.
I have things on the record, I can't make this up, I'm not making up anything, I don't know.
They don't know who you are when you, there's no picture of you.
Well.
Are you in favor?
That's the way you play it.
Then I'm with you.
Okay, so these two lots.
He's in favor of it, then I'm with you.
Those lots, yes, sir.
I don't care.
And this lot right here.
Well, see, I actually live up around the corner on Rollins.
You know what? I don't want to be the person. I had a long day. I don't want to make any problems.
Just was curious.
We'll have to show, when we do a site plan, we're going to show any issues properly.
I don't have anything, that's why I came here to form one. Is that fair answer?
See, well, you marked it off in red.
Okay.
I came here to get somebody to pay.
There's a deed that allows entry to the right of way.
The bank's across the street.
I got a road one for you. If that right of way services lot 37, was it ever, do you think was ever established that it was to service it in a commercial aspect?
I don't know, because when did your ordinance come into effect?
71.
71? The lot most recently was conveyed from a lot that was created in 1953, so I kind of doubt.
Probably not. Back then, they probably didn't even think of that.
Exactly, so, you know, it was next to the railroad tracks, you use it for what you want to use it for. You want to put a mansion there, fine, whatever. So the lot has been there for a long time.
Don't you just love when you're trying to fix a mess that's as old as some people are? Or older than some people are in this room, how's that?
It's not unusual in New England.
Good point.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, it says adopted 1971, I should have known that. Because we had a planning board, we didn't have a board of appeals. So they walked across the street and asked the postmaster if he would take over the board of appeals. I said, dummy, I said, yeah. So that's where we are. So you think we're young and foolish. But if you love your town, you work for it. So, gentlemen, where are we going here tonight? We can vote up and down, we accept the application, and then if we refuse it, he's dead, doesn't go anywhere with it. If we adopt it with some recommendations to the planning board, then he moves on to the planning board. For the site review process and all the hard questions that we've been asking here tonight will have to be addressed, they'll have to be fulfilled. So, the decision will rest with us. We find numbers here. Do you want to make an up and down vote and just take the chance that he'll be defeated right here tonight? That will be the end of this case. Never hear about it again.
I'm in favor of up and down vote, Mr. Chairman.
Or else do you have, the other alternative would be our recommendation that they study the safety issues, the potential of wells in the area, that the planning board take that under consideration. They may not, but usually they do. They take our considerations in the past very seriously and vote on that. And then this gentleman will have at least a life, put it that way. Otherwise, if we vote him down tonight, I don't think he goes anywhere. with this particular proposal.
So I can vote tonight?
And up and down?
Yeah.
Granted or refusal, okay. Then we're ready for the vote. A yes vote will grant the applicant the variances he's requesting, specifically to section 5-2A, the non-conforming use. A no vote will deny it. Okay? You got it, sir?
Yep.
Now we're gonna start this one. Mr. Shabbat, how do you vote?
Vote no.
Shabbat votes no. Mr. Cazal?
No.
Mr. Cazal votes no. Mr. Foss?
I
You need any rationale, Joe?
Well, yeah, we need the rationale because, yeah, what is your rationale?
Yes, mine is that I'm denying a variance for a self-storage facility in an urban residential area because it's a non-permitted use, and it's against the spirit of the ordinance, and there is not a hardship.
It's the spirit of the ordinance.
There is not a hardship proven tonight.
Okay. Mr. Foss?
I'm gonna vote no.
Foss vote no.
Part of my no goes back to the Norm Giroux proposal to try to build down there. We had the same residents coming in. My suggestion to the residents is to see if they could get the state to maybe at least make that a one-way road. They would come down happy about it. You know, I don't have a fix.
How do you do that?
Well, I would imagine you start right across the hall.
Yeah, we're holding a vote right now.
So with that being said, if you were to, I think if the applicant was able to come up with some more info, I might be able to change my vote. But as it stands now, the answer is no.
More info about traffic?
Traffic is one thing, you know, a lot of the planning board questions, I think you'd have to get your neighbors to support your wishes.
Okay, yours is a no vote.
Yes,
Mr. Hinchman?
I vote no, and the basis is that, I think the burden of proof is on the applicant. I feel that there's been insufficient proof that the values of surrounding properties will not be diminished. More importantly, I think that the applicant has not borne the burden of proving that enforcement of the ordinance would result in unnecessary hardship. While the applicant may have some belief about septic or water and sewer, we've heard from other neighbors that indicate that that isn't the case, and I don't think there's a hardship here, and would vote no.
Okay. Mr. Coward votes yes, because I think I'm a believer, and probably it's an eyesore. It's been an eyesore forever, and there's some beautiful pieces of property in Oak Street, and it's being destroyed by that mess in the center right by the tracks. And I would have loved to see the planning board probably take this under control. And so that's my reasoning for voting to allow it to go to the next party. So the case is defeated 4-1. This case is adjourned.
Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Before you all go, we need to pass a motion to accepted the updated fees, application fees, which were approved by the select board.
You know, if you look at the, over there, the fees are set by you, actually.
No, they have to go through the plan administrator,
they have to select board approval, but just as a... We paid for the cost of the public side.
Yes, I understand that, but the updated ones reflect the real cost of notification. We've done it with the planning board. I understand that. Yeah, the ZBA still needs to make a motion to accept the updated application fee.
What is the updated application fee?
So the updated application fee is $200 for the plan. Like, classroom notification and $10 per a butter.
mostly managed for 37 years. There's no such figure that comes up, exact figure. Certified mail so much.
Right, but that...
Notifications of the building, I was a stripper for Congress.
Okay, so if you...
I'm the editor of the Legionnaire.
If you have an issue with it, you need to take it up with the select board because they need to raise the fees to cover the real cost of the notification. They're not making any profit. Okay, so regardless, there needs to be a motion. If you want to be in opposition of it, that's fine, but we do need to make a motion to approve this.
We already have, it says that the applicant will pay for the notification process.
Right.
We have to amend that.
But we, again, like they, we have updated the fees, so...
The planning board has, we have it.
The select board has accepted the new fees, so...
But they haven't heard from the ZBA.
Right.
No compliance from us.
I don't know why you wouldn't comply. I mean, this, they reflect the real costs. Research was done.
The real cost to me is, I go to the post office, and they give me a receipt, it says what it cost me to send out those notifications.
Right, but it costs above that because it costs somebody to actually prepare that. So I'm getting paid for that. Right, but you don't do that anymore.
So what's happening?
So I do that and I get paid for it. So the applicant should cover that cost. It shouldn't be the burden of the town to pay for the cost.
So the day of volunteers is gone.
What I can say, Mr. Chairman, is there was a presentation, a very thorough presentation to the planning board, and the cost that, the fees that are being suggested here are actually, I believe, lower and in line with other towns and is not gen, it's not generated to make a profit. It's being suggested to cover shortfalls.
Break even.
It's a moneymaker, yeah.
Well, I don't, if it covers shortfalls, if it's close to a net zero, I don't expect, I think it's a...
The way that the federal government does it, they do it on the back of the veterans and soldiers. I fought that battle all my life. No, I'm not opposed to it. I'm not gonna make the motion.
Okay, would somebody else like to make the motion to accept the updated?
I'd like to make a motion to accept the updated fees and...
Yeah, accept it.
Okay, thank you.
You know, you've been a lot arguing, but nobody said anything. What's the fees?
It's $10 per abutter and $250 for newspaper notification.
$250?
Yeah, the real cost of posting in Foster's has gone up hugely. I mean, some of the posts that we put in are $375, so $250 is the median. And it's a low median.
Wow, I didn't know.
Yeah. So we lose a lot, the town itself loses a lot of money on notification that applicants should pay for. I mean, that's just...
I agree with that, but each one should be, it couldn't be a different price, right?
Yeah, but it was decided that we can't do that because they need to pay the application fees upfront.
Yeah, but you could have less abutters.
Well, if they, when you submit an application, you submit an abutter list, so you know in advance how many abutters you have.
That seems fair.
Yeah, so if you have 10 abutters, you submit $100. If you have 5 abutters, you submit $50. You know that ahead of time because to submit an application, you have to submit a list of abutters. So they have to come into the town office
and find
out.
Let's go back to this first guy who's here tonight.
Okay.
If he wants to go to an appeal, all back through and repay it again?
Yeah, he had to pay twice because the date that we adjourned him to, he couldn't make, so we had to re-notice everybody. So he had to pay for it twice. That's just the rules of the time. I mean, that's just how it is.
Okay, what about now? Is this going to be the third time around if he appeals it?
If he appeals it, yes, he will have to do notification. Yeah, because he's gonna resubmit an application. I mean, he can't resubmit what he submitted. It didn't get passed.
Well, I understand that. But I mean, the way he was talking is he wants to appeal it, and he's going to end up right back in front of us.
Right.
Now we're going to deny
it. But that's his choice. I mean, he can,
then
you can do it or not.
Yes, that, well, yeah, as we well know, Malcolm McNeil, right?
Yeah.
He was a tough nut.
He was good, though.
Oh, yeah.
So are you opposed to it, or did we unanimously approve the fees?
You had a motion and a second.
So I think that therefore we need to vote on it, right? Because we have a motion to.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
So whether or not we're gonna vote on it, now we need to vote on it.
There's a motion.
Right, so.
There's a motion on the floor.
You proposed a motion, Paul seconded it, now does the board.
Yeah, there's a motion on the floor, it's been discussed, to accept the set fees established by the select board of the town of Robinson for all appeals. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no?
No.
Okay.
So four yes and one no.
One no, that one guy, that one guy.
And it, you know, everyone's gonna have to wait.
Like on your board, that finger with a curve.
No, 3-1-1-1, 3-1 affirmation.
Have you got a new chairman now, any in the plant?
Yes.
Yes, yeah.
He waited for like 10 years and he said he did his time and was tired. He'd actually been talking about stopping for like a year and a half.
I know he'd been talking about it, but when I saw Miles' name, I was kind of shocked because I didn't know when that happened.
Right. Like, I think he's presented two meetings so far. I think this will be his third.
Yep.
Coming up next month.
Just between me and you, this guy was here for this